सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। ॐ सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करं शङ्करं शङ्कराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। ओम भद्रं कर्णे विश्वयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैः स्तुष्ट्वांसस्तनुभिः यशेम देवहितं यदायुः। स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति न पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो वरिष्ठमेनिः स्वस्ति नौ बृहस्पतिर्दधातु। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। हरि ओम। सल्यूटेशन्स टू ऑल। फर्स्ट टू लाइन्स ऑफ द शांति मंत्र वी सॉ। ओम भद्रं कर्णेभिः शृणुयाम देवाः। मे वी लिसन टू व्हाट इज ऑस्पिशियस। भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः एंड मे वी सी व्हाट इज ऑस्पिशियस। देवाः मीन्स द देवतास, यजत्राः मीन्स द वर्शिपफुल वंस। सो एज आई हैव सेड, दिस इज द प्रेयर टू द देवतास टू ensure that our study becomes auspicious. So what we see, may it be auspicious. What we hear, may it be auspicious. Now, the next one. Sthirai rangai is tushtuvagam sastanubhihi. What should be the quality of our life? That we live a healthy life. In Yakshaprashna, there is a question that is asked to Lord, to Yudhishthir by Yaksha. What is the great blessing? And he says, good health. Good health in this today's context of the pandemic, all of us know, even otherwise, we should remember this whole prayer is in the context of the Upanishads, to study the Upanishad to gain the knowledge. So body is important. One should take care of the body because the instrument to realize, the best instrument to realize is the human body. Many people think that Vedanta says you are not the body, so why to take care of the body? Vedanta doesn't say neglect the body. Vedanta says don't pamper the body, don't think you are the body. We are very funny people. When we buy a phone, with that what all we will buy? Think about it. The cover of the phone, then the protective shield of the phone. So many things we buy, no? Why? The phone must be safe, you know, the screen should not get scratched. The phone should not get scratched. Phone we will take care, but body? Arya Swamiji, we are Vedanti. And they will apply this for all the wrong reasons. They will eat anything, they say, I am anyway not the body, so how does it matter if I have diabetes? Body has diabetes. Body is eating rasagulla. I am not eating. I am Sakshi Matra, Chin Matra. Kaivalya Upanishad also they will quote, Chin Matroham Sada Shivaham. One has to take care of the body. As long as one doesn't realize this is the only instrument. When we will get next human body, no idea. So the prayer here is sthirai rangai. Let the body, all the limbs be firm, steady, healthy. Tushtuvagam sastanubhi, with whole body, all the various limbs, they must be healthy. Otherwise what happens? Back pain, knee pain, leg pain, head pain. One joke I read somewhere, this man, he went to the doctor. He said, "Doctor, if I touch my head, it pains. If I touch my chest, it pains. If I touch my thigh, it pains. If I touch my stomach, it pains." "It's terrible, doctor. Continuously it is paining. Do I have some terrible disease?" Doctor said, "No, you have a broken finger, that's all." You have a broken finger, with that, whatever you touch, it will pain. Our mind is also like that. Broken mind, whatever we touch, bhasmasura, this mind is gone. It does. So body must be healthy. No pain. So exercise must be done. I always give this formula. Fest. If you take care of these four aspects, life will be a festival. Body will be very cooperative. Fest, F-E-S-T. If we don't take care of these four, it will be a pest. What is F-E-S-T? Food. Sattvic food, appropriate quantity, appropriate quality. Eaten with appropriate bhav. Exercise. Tomorrow morning we have morning walk, for that only. Exercise has to be there. Otherwise, Vedant will not go inside. Activity required, body must be fit. Food, exercise, sleep. We have not kept anything much after dinner. Only 2 days we have. One day, one night walk and one valedictory. 3-4 days, nothing after dinner. So that you can sleep. So you are fresh in the morning, aarti onwards. So sleep, proper sleep we must have. 7 hours, generally people say minimum. If you are a yogi, then you may need less time, but otherwise 7 hours. And T, training of the senses. If our senses are not in control, we see anything, eat anything, talk anything, we will waste energies. So food, exercise, sleep and training of the senses, F-E-S-T. If this much we take care, body is fine. And why are we asking devatas here? All this is in our hands. Why are we asking devatas? Those of you who have studied Tattvabodh, you know that the phenomenal forces, the devatas, they are the presiding forces which govern the functioning of the body. Chakshusha Suryaha, Rasanayaha Varunaha, Dhranasya Ashvinav, Shrotrasya Digdevata, Vacho Vayuhu, all the 5 senses of knowledge, there are devatas. Devatas doesn't mean ki they are controlling these. They are presiding forces because of which these function. Don't say, "Swamiji, I slapped, you know." But actually it is Indra who made it happen. Don't blame me. Why? Because Indra is the devata of the hands. Hastayor Indra. So I just slapped. I didn't even know I was going to slap, it just happened. Attack. It is not like that. Devatas are presiding forces, they govern the functioning. How we use it is our job. Gurudev used to give the example. You apply, you have a building, you are building a new building. Then you have to apply to the municipality for water connection, electricity connection, all that. So they are the devatas. You have to go, please them. Then they will give the connection. After that, how you use water in your house, does municipality govern that or you? It is your choice. It is like that. So, sthirai rangai stushtavagam sastanubhi. Vyashema devahitam yadayuhu. And may we spend the life which is devahitam, which is sanctioned by the devatas. Whatever is the lifespan, that much, yad ayuhu, means not 1 minute lesser, not 1 minute more. Whatever lifespan is allotted at that time, till that time may the quality of my life be great. And what is the meaning of quality of my life be great? For a sadhak it is satsang, sadhana. Sadhana maya should be the life. Then the quality of life is great. One may be doing work, one may be having a family, all that also is sadhana only. You know, you saw in the movie, accident is your training. We think that this is not training, that is not training. So we think the sadhana means only specifically when we do certain things. Now, Swamiji, COVID has spoiled all our plans. You know, I wanted to go here, go there, Kailash Mansarovar, we planned, it couldn't happen, that sadhana has left. Array, but through the COVID, to face COVID situation, to accept it as it is, to live in equanimity, that itself is sadhana. Our mind will always think what I don't have or what I missed out. So many people, they tell, Swamiji, if I had got this knowledge at younger age, you know, my life would have been very different. It is true, life would have been different, there is no doubt. But why we didn't get that? Some karma only, no? At right time only it will get, we will get the knowledge. So make the best of that time. From that time onwards, make the life sadhana. Then what will happen? No, when somebody becomes elderly, they say, but Swamiji, now what can we do? Bahut gayi, thodi rahi, is samay to sadhana ho nahi sakti hai, abhi agle janam mein dekhenge. And should not do that. Yashema devahitam yadayu. Whatever is the ayu I am destined to live, may I live remembering Bhagavan. If we understand this karma siddhant well, there is nothing called accidental death. Or premature death, sorry, not accidental death. There is no premature death. People drop their body only when their karma is over. And Bhagavan is the karma phala data. Right at the time of birth itself, it is decided that this much karma is there to be exhausted, and this time the body will drop in this way. That is called the prarabdha karma. Till the prarabdha doesn't get over, body will last, whether we like it or not. No, Swamiji, I don't want to live anymore. Ho gaya mera kaam, mujhe jana hai yahan se. This is not like a hotel where we can check out at our will. Karma we have done earlier, now mukta phai. What else can be done? It is like that criminal sentence. Life is not a, what you call it, a punishment, but I'm just giving an example. It is like that. If it has been told that, okay, for this action that you have done, now 7 years you have to be in jail. Matlab 7 years. No, Swamiji, in that they have, you know, for good conduct, if you do good, then they release you 2 years early also. That is possible. So like that, if I do good, then maybe I can get exit earlier here. That is limitation of example. That's all. We will not leave early and we will not leave later. So no point in saying, Bhagavan, please bless me with long life. Already life is destined, finished. If we want to pray, we can pray. But Bhagavan says, this already life is destined. This much only it will be. No, Swamiji, but Markandeya got immortality. He didn't ask for long life. Please remember, what did he ask? He said, I am holding on to Lord Shiva. That's all. Did he ask for long life? He didn't ask. Shankaracharya, did he ask, I have such a brilliant life, you know, only 16 years. What is this? It's unfair. Vedavyasji extended his life by 16 years. He didn't ask. And those are exceptional cases. So what is there for us to learn in this? How much ever time we have, let us make the best of it. And how much ever time people have, we should make best of that time with those people. Nothing more and nothing less can be done. No, Swamiji, I wanted to spend more time, but that person went away. I am so sad. They went because their karma, they will go. What can we do? And somebody is not going, so we cry. Arey, kyun nahi ja rahe? सब कुछ खत्म हो गया, स्टिल दिस पर्सन इज नॉट गोइंग. आवर माइंड लिव्स लाइक दैट. हाउ डू वी नो देयर कर्म इज ओवर? भगवान ओनली नोस. आर वी नॉट सीइंग सो मेनी पेशेंट्स फॉर इयर्स दे आर इन कोमा, बट देन अगेन दे रिवाइव सम वन डे, सडनली दे विल कम आउट ऑफ इट, और समटाइम्स दे डोंट कम आउट, दे जस्ट गो. वॉट डिटर्मिन्स? Even if you have thought about it, other day I was talking on Prashna Upanishad, that time we discussed this. What makes us wake up from the sleep? From deep sleep, what makes us come out? It's only our vasanas and karma. That is how we come out. Otherwise we won't come out from deep sleep. So many people, their karma got over, vasana got exhausted for that janma. Gone, no, in sleep they go away. So the prayer is Yashema Devahitam Yadayuhu, meaning may we not ask for more, may we not feel this was less and we could not do. Make the best of life. Yashema Devahitam Yadayuhu. Swastina Indro. Now the specific devatas. So first two lines are the prayer from the devatas. Now which devatas are being invoked here? So here he says, Swastina Indra Vriddhashravaha. May Indra, who is most ancient, be auspicious to us. Indra is the king of devatas. He is the presiding deity of the hands. He is the presiding deity of rains also. Today Indra Bhagwan was very happy with us when we went to forest. He showered his blessings on us. So Swastina Indra already we experienced. Today you see Shanti Mantra we experienced in the forest. Badram Karne Bhi Shunayama also we experienced. Then Badram Pashya Maksha Bhi Rajatra also we experienced. Sthire Rangai also we experienced. Then only we walked and we could come back. Vashema Devahitam Yadayuhu. Quality of life also very good. Swastina Indra Vriddhashravaha. Rain also happened. Gurudev is demonstrating the Shanti Mantra for us straight. So Swastina Indra Vriddhashravaha. May Indra be auspicious to us. Then Swastina Pusha Vishwavedaha. Pusha means sun, Surya Devata. So may that Pusha, Surya Devata, be auspicious to us. Without sun there is no life. Body itself will not survive. Earth itself would not have been possible what it is. Life on earth is possible because of sun. And do you know, in Bhavishyottara Purana and other Puranas, very clearly they have written what all happens in Kali Yuga. In that one of the things they have written is, the sun will come closer to the earth, the temperatures will keep increasing, there will be flooding on the earth. All those things which they have written is exactly what is global warming. And they have written lot of details about the destruction that happens in Kali Yuga and the final pralay. We are right now only in some 2000th year of Kali Yuga. 430,000 years more to go, and already we are feeling climate. It is not climate change anymore. What it is, you know, climate crisis. It is climate crisis now, already. So we have to pray, Surya Bhagwan, please be auspicious to us. For that, we also have to be auspicious to the devatas. Our problem is, we want all auspiciousness from them, but all the things where they abide, that we are abusing. So Swastina, Swastina Pusha Vishwavedaha. Swastinas Tarkshyo Arishta Nemihi. May Tarkshya, who is the Vayu Devata, who destroys all the enemies, Arishtas or negativities, may that Vayu Devata be auspicious to us. Vayu is one thing which works silently and it purifies everything. If a closed room, you open up, put on the fan, that stuffiness in that room goes the moment air enters. Air is that, in that oxygen is there because of which we are alive. But no credit. None of them want any credit. Surya is shining 24/7. No Sunday for the sun. selflessly serving. Same way, Vayu, Swastinastakshyo Arishtanemihi. Swastino Brihaspati Dadhatu. And may Brihaspati, the guru of the devatas, be auspicious to us. So he is the guru of devatas, but symbolically the guru tattva, be auspicious to us. Now these are the devatas. So one meaning of the devata is the adidaivik meaning, where these are phenomenal forces and they exist. Oh Swamiji, this is Upanishad time, you know, but do they exist even today? They exist even today. Just that we have forgotten the devatas, we have lost our Shraddha, so we are not propitiating the devatas. Otherwise the tradition of the Sanatan Dharma, the followers of the Vedic Dharma, is that every day one is supposed to propitiate the devatas through the Havan, Agnihotra, etc. is done for devatas. It is a part of our debt actually. Devaran it is called. Of the five debts, Devaran is this, where we are supposed to offer the offerings, because the offerings that we give in the yajna, that sustains the devatas, and they will sustain us through their blessings. In the Gita, third chapter, those of you who have studied, you know that. Devan bhavayatanena te deva bhavayantu vaha. We must propitiate the devatas, the devatas will bless us. Parasparam bhavayanta shreya paramavapsyatha. Mutually cooperating with each other, attain the highest. That is the attitude. So it is not an option. Today you think about it, we have gone so far away from our Vedic Dharma. It is the primary duty of the Grahasthi to do the Agnihotra every day. Because it is that Agnihotra which the Grahasthi does that sustains the Devatas and sustains the creation, and through the Grahastha Ashram, Brahmacharya, Vanaprastha and Sannyas get sustained. Today too one is proud to say, I am not a ritualist. I don't believe in ritual. Very good. Everything else they will make a ritual of it, they will follow. But Havan one has to do, Yajna one has to do, Puja one has to do, that one will not do. Swamiji, I light one lamp, is it alright? One lamp in front of Bhagwan I light every day. With great bhav I light. Bhagwan doesn't need our lamp. We require to tune up with the devatas. No? It is our duty. No, nobody is doing today. You will be surprised, there are some people who are even today very strictly adhering to Vedic Dharma, but that number is very small. We have to do the duty of ours. Even today, if you want to learn, there are people who teach Agnihotra, and in a small kund you can do. It takes not even more than 15 minutes. One can do. So it's a duty. So one is the devatas are the adidaivik forces. Now here there is also a deeper meaning of these four. Indra, we know that Indra is the presiding deity of the hands. So Indra symbolizes self-effort. But may we put our self-effort, because to walk the path of spirituality is very difficult. Lot of effort has to be put against our own senses and the mind, because they only take us for a granted. So Indra represents that sense of self-effort. Indra. Then Pusha represents grace of Bhagavan. The self-effort with the grace of Bhagavan, both are required to walk the spiritual path. Why do we say Pusha is grace of Bhagavan? Because Pusha is like, so the example always given for grace of Bhagavan. Yesterday Madhavananji spoke to you about Samanya Kripa and Vishesh Kripa, right? So the example of Kripa is the Surya. Gurudev himself used to give that example. that grace is like sunlight, which is everywhere. Samanya kripa is like the sunlight, which is everywhere. But Vishesh kripa is like the solar cell, where we are able to tap the energy of the sun and use that special energy for whatever purpose we want to. So Pusha represents that. So these two words, these two lines represent the combination of self-effort and grace of Bhagavan. In the Gita also we have Krishna Bhagavan and Arjun. What do they represent? In the last verse of the Gita, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partho, Dhanurdhara, Tatra Shrihi, Vijayo Bhutihi, Dhruva Nitir, Matir Mama. So there also one of the meanings is Arjun is the dynamic man of action representing self-effort. And Krishna Bhagavan is grace. Many times what happens, we do only self, we believe only in self-effort. I am a self-made man, I did it all by myself, there was nobody with me, I came alone in this city, now I made an empire, now I am this, I am that. Which is good at one level, that person has achieved a lot. But one should never forget, it is only by grace of Bhagavan. Then there are people who will say everything is only grace, grace, grace. Why don't you do some japa? No, it is grace of Bhagavan. When he wants, he will liberate. Why don't you do sadhana? No, no, no. Grace, kripa. Jab unki kripa barsegi, tab apne aap ho jayega. Andar se humko prerna aa jayegi. That is not actual dependence on grace. That is hiding behind the excuse of grace to encourage tamoguna. And we may think it is grace. So that's why grace and self-effort should be together. We should do our best and then we leave the rest, saying it is kripa of Bhagavan, and what best we did also is kripa of Bhagavan only. So that is the meaning of Indra and Pusha. Tarkshya means satsang. Oh, how did Tarkshya mean satsang here now? One meaning of the word Tarkshya is Garudji. Garud, Garudji. And Garudji is a Vahan. Whose Vahan?
Vishnu
Bhagavan's Vahan. Vahan, what is the job of the Vahan? Is to bring the Vahak. What brings the knowledge of the Supreme Lord or the Self to us is a satsang. And satsang purifies also. So the company of the devotees, Garudji represents the devotees, sadhu sangati, bhakta sangati. These devotees bring satsang in our life. So Garudji is that devotee and hence he is representing satsang. And that is one very important prayer one should ask Bhagavan, please keep blessing me with satsang. Wealth can come and go, popularity can come and go, health can come and go, everything can come and go, but satsang should not go, it should only keep coming. Because then we will get out of this ocean of samsara. Because the moment we get disconnected from satsang, again the mind goes into downfall. Continuous satsang and company of such devotees when we have, that is the most powerful. Devotees like Garudji, Naradji, they are such great devotees of Bhagavan. Even in Tulsi Ramayana to Shabari, Bhagavan Ram, when he is explaining Navada Bhakti, first step of Bhakti, what does he say? Prathama Bhagati Santanakara Sangha. Do have the company of saints. That's why in our culture the sadhu sangati, bhakta sangati is considered very auspicious, because only through that we get initiated on the path. So Tarkshya means that. And Brihaspati is the guru tattva. So satsang of the devotee is definitely, but satsang of a satguru is the best. So many of us are also speaking on Vedanta. But when Gurudev speaks, what it is? He doesn't have to speak also. One smile, one glance, one look, one silence is enough. Hours and hours we may speak, but we can't do anything. His one word will touch the heart straight. That's the power of Sadguru. You know, it is said, if you see about Diksha, you know, Sadguru can give Diksha. So it is said Mantra Diksha is the lowest. Or, you know, when they initiate a person into the mantra with the words, they say it is the lowest form of Diksha. Greater than Mantra Diksha is Sparsha Diksha. By touch, they can initiate. Greater than touch is just by the look, Chakshu Diksha. Greater than the look is by thought. Thought, vichar. Amazing things are there in our scriptures. And there are masters who have shown this. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa did all the three to Vivekananda. He touched with his toe, he touched the heart of Vivekananda, and Vivekananda went into Samadhi. 3 days he was in that Samadhi. Sparsha Diksha. Vichar Diksha also he did. And just before he was passing on from this body, at that time also, just imagine Vivekananda's mind, he has this question that if at this time he says, I am God, I am ready to believe him. That much skepticism had gone into Vivekananda because of the Sangha that he had earlier. He was in Brahma Samaj, they don't believe in idols and form and all of that. And Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is full bhakta of Kali Ma. For a long time, Vivekananda did not accept him. He tested him also. And in experiences also he got, many experiences he got. Still, when Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is passing on, this thought is in his mind. If at this time he says, I am God, I am ready to believe him. The next moment he says, he who came as Ram, he who came as Krishna is in front of you as Ramakrishna. Vivekananda accepted full surrender, complete. It is at that time, through his eyes, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa said, I am transferring all my spiritual power to you. Did Chakshu Diksha. Fabulous. What all our scriptures say, but we should remember one point here. The adhikari will be the one who will benefit from all this. You know, Gurudev, somebody went and asked, Swamiji, Ramakrishna touched Vivekananda, he went into Samadhi, will you touch me? He said, are you Vivekananda? And if I touch you, only my hand will get dirty. And also what happens is, because of all these, we forget, we think that it will all come free to us. Just one guru has to touch me, oh, then I will be liberated. Aap kya itna mehnat kar rahe ho, attending camp and Kaivalya Upanishad and listening, reflecting, meditating so many years. All that is not required. Just find one guru and tell that guru to touch you and kaam ho gaya. That unfortunately has also led to the downfall of the culture because we stopped doing our self-effort. That's what I just said earlier. No? Self-effort plus grace has to be there. We forgot our self-effort. Then we believe in some Baba, some miracle, some touch, some light, some miracle and some producing something. We have to keep doing when the right teacher has to come in the right way. What we need, it will happen if it has to happen. Tapon Maharaj, did he touch Gurudev? Think about it. He taught Gurudev. He didn't even give Mantra Diksha to Gurudev in that way. But he taught and Gurudev realized. So we should remember that. The reason why I am saying this is the power of Sadguru. The different levels which are there. In that, general satsang is one aspect. Satsang of somebody who is advanced, who is walking the path, who is a great devotee is one level, but satsang of the Sadguru is completely different level. So when we are asking Brihaspati ji's grace, it is that may I have a Sadguru in life. That's why in our culture it is said never die without a Guru. A person who dies without a Guru is considered unfortunate. Nigura they call him. One must have a Guru. The reason is because that human life can be utilized best only when one gets a Guru like that. Which applies in many things, no? In sports also, if you want to achieve Olympics gold medal, then you have to have that type of a trainer who will have that ability to lift your performance to those levels. Recently in Olympics, so many of our sportsmen and women, they have won the medals. So they had, you know, how many years they have been training and under some specific coaches and going through such rigorous discipline, then their game is lifted to another level. To compete at the international level, one requires that type of exposure. So one is the Adi Daivik meaning we discussed, then the Adi Bhautik meaning we discussed. Now we will discuss the Adhyatmik meaning of the Devatas. Indra also is symbolic of the mind. The etymological meaning of Indra is that Idam Drashta Iti Indraha. One who is the observer is the Indra. So Indra has different meanings in the Vedic literature. But one of the meanings of Indra is the mind. So here, may my mind be auspicious to me. By saying may Indra be auspicious, that means may my mind be auspicious. Then Pusha means the Buddhi. So mind be auspicious meaning emotional disturbance should not be there in the mind. Otherwise we are sitting in the class but emotions are very disturbing, the mind keeps going somewhere or the other. Raga and Dvesha, they will create that. Some attachment to some person I have, I will keep thinking about them only. Or somebody I hate or somebody caused me pain, then I will keep remembering that. So emotions can disturb a lot. May that emotions not disturbed and may the emotions become purified, that devotion is invoked in our heart. So that is the meaning of Indra. Pusha means the Buddhi. So Buddhi must be open. When we listen, there are different types of listening. One is called factual listening, to listen to things as it is. Other is called filtered listening, to listen only what we want to listen. Ignore rest of the things. Some type of listening is where we want, where we listen only with a preconceived notion that we will not be able to accept a new idea. We want a confirmation of our beliefs. We listen for that. So there are different types of listening, but the best type of listening is where I am open and I am listening to it as though I am listening for the first time. So this Buddhi must be like that, open-minded. Otherwise what happens to us is, like see today the movie we saw. Some of you said after seeing the movie that we have seen this earlier, but after today we absorbed something more, something new or something deeper. So you have seen the movie earlier also, but again when you see with an open mind, so many new things go inside, or something which you already knew goes much more deeper, much more better understanding. That is attitude. So may the Buddhi be open. May I not listen with preconceived notions. And also what happens is sometimes we are listening to find fault in the speaker. Or we compare. Maja nahi, wo speaker better tha. The same text I heard from somebody else, that was amazing, you know. This was okay. The bhav of my sadhana went somewhere else only. I am sitting and judging the speaker. Or nothing new the speaker said, everything I knew already. Buddhi has to be open. So Pusha means that. May I listen with an open-minded intellect. And grasp the logical sequential thought flow. That is very important in us. Gnana Marg especially, this thought flow is important because conviction comes from the proper understanding of the logical thought flow. Otherwise we confuse. So buddhi means that buddhi works on logic, rationality. So buddhi means may I grasp properly. Then tarksha, arishtanemi. Tarksha here means our prana. May our pranas don't disturb. Swamiji, why will prana disturb? Are prana functions are terrific. Right now also prana may be disturbing you. 8:30, bahut late hai khane ke liye. My time is 8 o'clock. Evening tea, they didn't give anything, no biscuit, nothing with that. And 3:30 they gave tea, and now it is. Mind, you know, hunger, thirst, yawning, sneezing, sweating, so many of these, they are the functions of this prana. So this prana, may that prana be auspicious to us, meaning don't, it should not create restlessness. And Brihaspati. So who is the Brihaspati here? Brihaspati here subjectively again means the Brihaspati is the guru in the subjective interpretation. Brihaspati is the buddhi and Pusha is the eyes, because the presiding deity of our eyes is the sun. In Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat we also say buddhi, so that way meaning is correct, but Brihaspati is the buddhi here in this context, subjective meaning. So Pusha will become the eyes. So now this is the meaning. Om Shanti, Shanti and Shanti. May there be no disturbances from Adidaivik, Adibhautik, Adhyatmic forces. So if you see what is this whole Shanti Mantra about, very nicely it is said, the Shanti Mantra asks for 5 things. First, it asks for Arogya, good health. Second, it asks for Mangal Anubhav, that may my experiences be auspicious. Third, it asks for Pratibandha Nivritti, may all the obstacles get removed, Pratibandha Nivritti. Fourth, it asks for Anugraha, that may Kripa of Bhagavan be there, Devatas be there. And fifth, it asks for Shanti, that may the mind and intellect be peaceful, may the surroundings be peaceful, may the cosmic forces be peaceful. Just imagine, if it starts raining, you know this green covering which is here? If it rains heavily, we will not be able to have this peaceful satsang. The amount of sound that produces is terrific. So these cosmic forces also, if they are not peaceful, our satsang won't happen. Beings around us also. Right now, nobody is creating any noise around us. Peacefully, we are doing our satsang. You know, next to the Samadhi, the green building that you see, white and green, that is the Vidhan Sabha. Legislative Assembly of Himachal is that. Ja ja ki yehi jaga inko mila. That for how many days in a year, you know? 15 days in a year, they use that place. For that, this huge construction. That also not every year. Only when it is extremely cold in Shimla, then they will do the session here. That time, bapre. Security is like anything here. How we just generally normally go out for a walk and, you know, go down the road or go out into the forest. Oh, you cannot do that. They control everything. So Adidaivik, Adibhautik, Adhyatmic forces, they all are quiet, so we are having. So this is the Shanti Mantra. Now we go into the text proper. So as we know, Upanishads are the conversations between the teacher and the student, most of them. So here also there is one student who has gone to the teacher. This is the beauty of our culture, is it is a dialogue, not a sermon always, and it is questioning is encouraged. You know, this lot of these blessings we take it for a ride. Now forget we taking it for a ride or taking it for granted. We don't realize and we question to a different extent completely, where we question the very need of this also. Why are Vedas required? Why are scriptures required? Nothing is required in this modern age. We are scientific, this, that. Still, our culture doesn't blame any of such people. They can still be Hindus. You can reject entire Hindu culture, not believe in God, etc. Still, you can be a Hindu. Try doing that in some of the other cultures. Freedom to change my culture, my religion also is there, no, in Hindu culture. Other people have that. And look at the things happening across the world today. Terrible. And still Hindus don't feel proud of their culture and their legacy. They look down upon their culture. That level of brainwashing has happened. And in today's age also, there are people who will not accept this, even though knowing a lot of facts and with so much knowledge available about our culture, about our glory, about what is happening in other cultures and how much suffering and sorrows are there because of that fanaticism. But we are still afraid to say. Raksha Bandhan went. I don't know if you are aware, some of you are aware, maybe you must be aware. But what a ruckus every year these people create about Raksha Bandhan. Patriarchic function it is. It is a symbol of patriarchy. And these are some of the Hindus only who will say this. And then there are others, so anyway they are waiting to demolish this culture. Tell me how the hell is Raksha Bandhan a patriarchy, function of patriarchy? Because we have not known only what is our culture, we say that it is patriarchy. Woman is not weak, sister doesn't need any protection, who is a brother to protect the sister? Are you, first of all, this sister and brother tradition has come so much later, it has evolved. Raksha Bandhan is not at all a function which started with brother sister. It's a Raksha Sutra that the priest would tie to the king. It's a Raksha Sutra that Indrani had tied to Sachi Devi. Indrani had tied to Indra. Sachi Devi had tied to Indra. Upon Brihaspati Rishi's suggestion, Indra was fighting with these asuras. He was not winning only. So Brihaspati Rishi called Indrani. He said, chant these mantras, make this Raksha Sutra, put this rice and turmeric and few things, and take a red cloth and then tie it to Indra, and that was done by Indrani to Indra, and then next day Indra went and won the war. What is a protection in that of a woman in that? The woman, the wife is tying it to the husband for the glory and victory there. The priest is tying it to the to the king. That may the king be protected, because yatha raja tatha praja, if the raja is protected, he will take care of the raja. And the dharma of the raja is to remind him that your job is to protect the praja. That is the origin of Raksha Bandhan in our Vedas, in our Puranas. And we chant the shloka also, which Lakshmi Devi, which is in the context of Lakshmi Devi. You know, Bali Raja, he was sent into the Sutala Lok. He surrendered himself to Vaman Bhagwan, so he was sent into Sutala Lok. Bhagwan became his Dwarpal. Now Lakshmi Devi is waiting there, Bhagwan took Vaman avatar, and now why he has not come back? Bhagwan is standing as the Dwarpal. So she came to know, Bhagwan is Dwarpal, so now what to do? So Narad ji, satsang she got, see, Narad ji said, you go and tie Raksha to this Bali Raja. So Lakshmi Devi comes and ties the Raksha Sutra to Bali Raja, and in gift, return gift, she gets Vishnu Bhagwan back. Where did this come that the sister is weak and the brother has to protect the sister? It is not there only. But look at the amount of ruckus. You go on Twitter and the social media and read Hare Ram. Things we can't speak, all those kind of things will be written there, maligning our culture. Why I am saying this to you is, one is we should know our culture. Second is we have to stand up against these people on the media, on the social media. We have to counter it. We don't have that force. We think our culture, our glory, even if I know, I will leave it by myself. Why should I, fight against somebody else? Please remember, it's not a personal fight. It is a fight for the dharma. That's a duty of ours. If somebody attacks your house, what will you do? Will you say, no, it's okay, you attack, do anything you want. I am non-violent person. I will not hurt you at all. I don't believe in hurting other people. I will just sit quietly. That fellow will come and chop your head. Ram Janma Bhumi verdict came. Just imagine, on those four judges, the entire Hindu population left the judgment to the four judges or not? And we accepted, and did we celebrate in a huge way? All the Hindu leaders, including our Chinmay Mission Swamis and all of us, we were told specifically that we should tell all our Hindu people that do not celebrate in a big way. We do not want to hurt the sentiments of others. We will ensure that communal harmony is maintained. But still there are Hindus only who will say, why is a temple even required? Build a school, build a hospital. That also we are doing. School and hospital also are being built by so many. But we don't realize all these things. Today what is happening, the biggest tragedy that has happened today, if you look at the history of that place, was that place not a Hindu place? If that can happen to that place, can that not happen to our country here? Think about those things. India's borders have been continuously shrinking only. What was Akhanda Bharat and what are we? Unfortunately, we have made this entire thing political, saying, no, this is all politics, we should not get into it. Very good. When those guys will enter into your house, that time keep thinking, hey, we made a blunder. We cannot imagine what can happen, Baba. The ideologies which are going across in the world, we cannot imagine what kind of dangers are there. So we are no doubt peace-loving people, but we are also people who will fight to protect our dharma. That second part we have forgotten. Completely forgotten. And the fights today are at different levels. It's not necessary that we have to take weapons and go and kill people. Nobody is saying that. But at least stand for dharma, no? If 10 people are criticizing, condemning, and our younger generation doesn't take it up only, because they are being fed all this big reputed media houses, look at the biased reporting that they do, and our young people get carried away so easily by that, then they will not follow any of this. That's how we lose so many traditions. Yesterday only one post I was seeing, this fellow, his hand is like this, foreigner, he's doing pranayama. And what is the post, Cardiac cohesive breathing is very, very beneficial to your lungs, to respiratory system, and extremely helpful to reduce anxiety and stress. Cardiac coherent breathing. What was this? Pranayam, yoga, anulom, vilom, we were doing. And are Hindus not saying today? Yoga is nothing to do with Hindu religion. International Yoga Day, all these posts will come out. Yoga is global. Yoga is nothing to do with religion. Then who created yoga? Your uncle created. It is from Hindu religion completely. Why am I shying? And Hindu saying yoga is nothing to do with religion is the saddest part. Why should Hindu say? You think the conspiracy which is there, all that which is good from Hindu culture, they will appropriate it, they will take it away to their culture, or they will make it completely so-called non-religious. And then what will remain? They will say, this is the pathetic Hindu culture, so destroy it. They will say caste system, animal sacrifice, this, that, all that is Hinduism. It is patriarchy, it is this, it is misogynistic, all kinds of nonsense they will talk. But Hindus will be docile. They will not speak anything. Cardiac cohesive breathing. Aray, you say cardiac cohesive breathing, I don't have a problem. But Hindu saying this is cardiac cohesive breathing and not yoga, that is a big problem. Foreigners coming from there to our country, learning so many things and going back, and then they are practicing all that and rewording so many things, and scientifically they do some experiments, which is great, no problem. But then give the due credit that this is from here. There was a whole conference, you know, which was to be held. I think they are not going to hold it now, but Dismantling Hindutva, September 11 to September 13, the whole conference funded by some 100 universities from abroad, and all the speakers are completely anti-Hindu, and so many of them are Indians in that. Luckily there are people who are today even now fighting for Hindu culture, so a lot of voice was raised and a lot of letters were written to various concerned people, and then now they are thinking two times now whether we should do. So we should remember these things. You may say, Swamiji, Upanishad mein ye sab aap kyun bol rahe hain? Because if Sanatan Dharma is not protected, Upanishad will not be available for us to read and understand two generations later. You think about that. So it is our duty to know the glories of our culture and pass it on to the people. Can people question? I had been to Goa. In one place I went, famous church of Goa. Every fellow throngs that place. The amount of torture that that person had done to Hindus and killed the number of Hindus, and the whole church is behind that person, festivals are happening, etc. So they had taken me also there. First time when I went to Goa. So with one group of youngsters we went there to see that church. So I went in the church and 2-3 youngsters were with me. So they were asking questions to the priest there, the father there. Literally, you know what the father said? Because the local person who was with us, he took us there. And the local person was asking the question. The father looked at him and said straight away, "Are you a Christian?" He said, "Yes." He said, "You will not get a grave. Don't ask questions here." In front of us, he said, straight, you will not get a grave. You are not allowed to question here. That is the understanding that they have. You cannot question their culture. Our culture is so open-minded. You can question. You can ask. If you don't understand, you can ask many more times. And if you still are not convinced, you need not believe also. No belief is being enforced on us. That's the freedom. And that's why I'm saying to be born as a Hindu is a great blessing. To be born in Bharat is a great blessing. No matter what the world may say. Each place has its own Mahatva, there's no doubt. But Bharat Mahatva is absolutely different. People who have Punya Karma they have done, they will be born in Bharat. So here we are, this question. Now who is the disciple here and who is the guru? See that. Atha ashvalayano bhagavantam parameshthinam upasamitya uvacha. So the disciple is Ashvalayana Rishi. ओम अथ अश्वलायनो हु इज द गुरु भगवंतम परमेष्ठिनम ही वेंट टू द क्रिएटर भगवान ब्रह्मा जी उपसमेत्य वेंट क्लोज टू द क्रिएटर एंड ही स्पोक थस सो दैट्स द मीनिंग ऑफ द फर्स्ट वन नाउ As you see here in the commentary also, Gurudev has written very nicely. Ashvalayana is a famous teacher in the Rig Veda and many are his mantras that go into the bulk of our accepted Hindu sacred books. This is the disciple who is not an ordinary person. Rig Veda is supposed to be the oldest Veda going by the so-called historians. We believe Veda is Anadi and Ananta, but even if they say by recorded history, Rig Veda is supposed to be the earliest Veda. And in that Rig Veda, there are many mantras which are revealed to Ashvalayana Rishi and they are a part of the Rig Veda. What does it mean? That the Rishi is already a very highly qualified, pure-minded person to whom great mantras are revealed. These Rishis are not ordinary people to whom mantras are revealed. They are people who have done great tapasya, lived in self-control, purified their mind. That person to whom mantras are revealed is the disciple of this Upanishad. Just think about it. What is the glory of Brahma Vidya then? So, that is Ashvalayana Rishi. Atha Ashvalayana. And now he goes to the teacher. See, one meaning here is Bhagavantam Parameshthinam means that he goes to the creator Brahmaji. Ashvalayana Rishi goes to Brahmaji. That is one meaning. But Bhagavantam Parameshthinam also means what? Every teacher is a Brahmaji. Why? Brahmaji is the creator. See, people like Gurudev, if they have not come into our lives, we would not even know that there is something called bondage. The desire to get liberated to comes only after we know that there is bondage, we feel the pain of bondage and then we want to come out of that feeling. If we don't even know that there is bondage, how will we come out? The work of a guru starts from then. From there onwards, to make the disciple aware what is called bondage and how one is suffering because of that bondage, and then show a higher state so that there is a willingness to come out of that bondage to get into that higher state. So every guru is Brahmaji, creates. Bhagavantam Parameshthinam. Now, there are different aspects to this Bhagavantam Parameshthinam. So as I said, every teacher is Brahma, is Brahmaji. Second meaning is Bhagavantam is there. So we have the bhav that Guru Sakshat Parabrahma. The Shastra goes to that extent of saying what? Guru may not be Parabrahma, but if you have the bhav that Guru is Parabrahma, you will realize. Guru is not Parabrahma, meaning has not realized Parabrahma. Otherwise, everyone is a manifestation of Parabrahma only. But the Guru may not have been realized. But if the disciple has that bhav, ki my Guru is realized, disciple goes across. So that is another meaning, Bhagavantam Parameshthinam. Then, there is a division that is given. So the word guru means somebody who removes the darkness of ignorance. Gu, gukaro, andhakara, syat, gukara, tannivaraka. So one who removes darkness of ignorance is called guru. So gurus can be many. Somebody teaches us maths or physics or chemistry or music, dance, sports. Each of them is a guru. Today people call management guru, like that. So guru is anyone who who removes darkness of ignorance. Then there is Param Guru, the teacher who is realized in the, who is abiding in the absolute self. It's called Param Guru. Then there is Parameshthi Guru, the teacher who is established in the truth, and the teacher in this context is the creator himself. Like we see Dakshinamurti Bhagwan himself taking avatar as a guru and giving the knowledge to Sanat Kumars. Oh, but Swamiji, what is the difference between Param Guru, Parameshthi Guru? See, Param Guru and Parameshthi Guru, the realization of both of them is the same. But Param Guru can be someone who has, who is a jiva, who has evolved to come to that level of realization of the self. Parameshthi Guru is Bhagwan himself. That Parameshthi Guru has not evolved through various lifetimes and sadhanas and then become. He is Bhagwan only. Dakshinamurti Bhagwan doesn't have avatars, does not have many lives where he has evolved and then become Dakshinamurti Bhagwan. He is straight Guru himself, the Lord himself was manifesting as the Guru, the Parameshthi Guru. So Guru, Param Guru, Parameshthi Guru. So that is the word here, Bhagavantam Parameshthinam. Upasametya, the disciple goes near the teacher. So the word Upasametya indicates approaching the teacher as per the Shastra, as per the Vidhi. And definitely here the Rishi Ashwalayana is the teacher who is well versed with the Vedic tradition, knowledge. So how does one approach the teacher? Traditionally it is said with samit in the hands. With the dry twigs, one makes a bundle, takes it, puts it on the head, goes to the teacher. Meaning with burning desire to know and ready to surrender. With that attitude one goes to the teacher. So upasametya and uvacha, he asked, he spoke. Now what did he speak? So let us see, first mantra comes now. Earlier was the background, now comes the first mantra. One thing I forgot to explain is the word atha. Ashwalayana I started from. Atha means thus or then. So that word atha indicates that the disciple has cultivated the qualifications necessary to realize the self or to come to the path of Vedanta. What are the qualifications? Fourfold qualifications. What is the first one?
Vivek.
Then second? Vairagya. Third? Shatka Sampatti. In that Shatka Sampatti, which is the first one?
Shama.
Control of the mind. Dhamma means?
Control of senses.
Uparama.
Withdrawal.
Then fourth, titiksha means forbearance. Five is not samadhan. Five is shraddha, faith. Faith in what? Scriptures and Ishwara. Guru and the scriptures. Guru Vedanta Vakya Dishu Vishwasaha Shraddha. Sixth one?
Samadhanam.
Absorption of the mind. So this is the Shatka Sampatti. What is the fourth qualification? Mumukshutva. Burning desire to know the truth. This Mumukshutva is very interesting. What is like, actually what is Mumukshutva? We say burning desire to know the truth, correct. But what is mumukshutva? Moksha may bhuyat, correct. May I get moksha. But moksha from what?
Ignorance.
Bondage, ignorance, correct. But it means actually moksha from this mind and intellect. Because that bondage is because of the mind and intellect. Avidya is expressing, avidya is root cause, no doubt, but it manifests as the desire here. Vasana is also unmanifest. It manifests as desire, then thoughts, then actions at the body level. So literally, moksho me bhuyat is, may I be liberated from the wrong notion that I am this jiva, I am this mind and intellect. Mind and intellect are only my equipment, I am not this. Akhandananji said, man se mukti hi moksha. Not that man will get destroyed and we will become, you know, dialogue in the movie was, the disciple says, I mean the Dan, he says to Sok, you are out of your mind. And what does Sok say? It has taken a lifetime of practice. And then Sok says, we want you also out of your mind. People use that very casual, you know, have you gone out of your mind? That is moksha, mumukshutva. Presented in modern way, out of your mind. That is mumukshutva. It is not that mind remains and it gets moksha. See, everything else, the mind remains as it is and then we get. Here mind only is gone. That is the difference between the worldly achievement and spiritual knowledge. Mind gone. So this disciple is ready to let go of the mind. And then he has gone to the teacher, who is Brahmaji. So that's the meaning of Atha. Atha means preparation earlier is indicated. Many of the sutras, they start like that. Like Brahma Sutra will start with that. Atha to Brahma Jignasa. Atha, it will start with that. Narad Bhakti Sutra also will start with Atha. Yoga Sutras, how does it start? First one is
Chitta Vritti Nirodha.
That is the definition. Yoga is the Chitta Vritti Nirodha. Before that, there is one. Atha and something it is. I don't remember. So, Atha indicates the preparation. Now comes the first mantra. Adhi Bhagavan Brahma Vidyam Varishtham. सदा सद्भि सेव्यमानां निगूढां यया चिरात् सर्वपापं व्यपोह्य अरात् परं पुरुषं याति विद्वान्. Now, what questions to ask the teacher? And the disciple is a highly competent disciple and teacher is none other than Brahmaji himself. Imagine, you and I are small little jivas. We itself, if somebody wants to talk to us, we say, I don't have time. Brahmaji is the creator of the whole world. And this disciple has gone to Brahmaji. So his time is extremely precious. And other thing we should know, Brahmaji's time is very different time. Our time is very different. One day of Brahmaji is so many. 1000 Chaturyugis is one day of Brahmaji. So imagine the Rishi also, what kind of Punya he must have done to go and ask Brahmaji and then receive his knowledge from Brahmaji in his time. No, no, Swamiji, it is not written he went to Brahmaji and listened to it in his time. Maybe Brahmaji manifested in front of him in this life, in human time, and then he has experienced. Both possibilities are there. Either way, it is the disciple who is Punyavan. So what question to ask Brahmaji? Very important. Gurudev used to joke many times. He said, what question to ask a sannyasi or a Swami or a Guru? One should be very clear. And he would explain, you know, if you go to a lawyer, do you go with some health problem? You ask lawyer only about law. If you go with a health problem, what the lawyer will say? If you say, I have diarrhea, lawyer will say, file a petition. What else can the lawyer say? You don't go to a doctor and discuss some engineering problem. You don't go to an artist and ask about some scientific problem. But you go to this teacher and ask all kinds of problems of the world. And teacher is supposed to know everything. How is that possible? Now some of you, my wife is not listening to me. I don't have a wife only. How can I answer? And Gurudev used to joke, he said, what can I tell you? Oh, give her a diamond ring. What else can I say? No, Swamiji, but my wife is not like this. He said, I don't have any type. I don't have a wife, so I don't know which type of wife to have. How can I explain to you? Very humorously used to explain all that. In Vivek Chudamani camp only. Are, how much humor. So what question to ask? Sometimes the disciple also is at that level, and Guru accommodates and brings up a disciple slowly, one by one, lifts the level. Like Tapon Maharaj, imagine for Tapon Maharaj, if you ask a question also to him, sometimes he would say, why are you wasting time? All answers are in you, don't ask me, go and reflect. That was the answer he would give to Gurudev. Gurudev would ask him sometimes a question based on the class. Tapon Maharaj would not answer only, he would say, all answers are in you, go and reflect, you will find answers. So even the question he is not answering, spiritual question. And one youngster came with the parents. Parents are devotees of Tapon Maharaj. So this youngster, he's come with all these jeans, t-shirt, all that, and he was there. And the parents have brought him so that some samskar will go into him. And Tapon Maharaj is talking about movies. What is the new movie you saw? Who is your favorite film actor? Who is that? And Gurudev is looking, what is happening here? And after a few time passed, just before they were leaving, Tapon Maharaj told this youngster, will you just follow one instruction? He said, yes. Every day, get up in the morning, watch the sunrise, and walk for 20 minutes. And sit down for a few minutes, and then come back home. That's all you have to do, nothing else. He didn't give him any other knowledge. He just told him, every day you get up in the morning, walk, watch the sunrise, come back. And he did. After a few months, when they came back, this fellow has come wearing traditional clothes, putting vibhuti and all that with the parents. And Gurudev saw, literally he saw in front of his eyes this transformation happening. So Tapon Maharaj asked him, what happened to you? He said, I followed your instruction. Every day I used to go walking and then go and see the sunrise. So after a few days, every day you see sunrise. After some time, the mind will turn introvert. Because how much can you keep seeing outside? Then I started reflecting about my life, what I'm doing with my life, what should be done, what can be my goal. And slowly, slowly, I started transforming. I spoke to my parents. They guided me. Go to this temple every day. And this can be your goal. And I started pursuing. And my mind, I feel more stronger now. So many things he said. Transform. Just one instruction of Tapon Maharaj, which is also not a so-called religious instruction. He didn't tell him, chant this mantra every day. Do this japa, do this mala. Nothing. What he told him? Walk for 20 minutes, watch the sunrise, sit quietly, and then come back. Power of solitude and power of the words behind. So the student is lifted by the teacher slowly, slowly. What all people have asked Gurudev, they would ask him, should we invest in this company or not? Just think. And sometimes Gurudev has guided also. Sometimes he has told people, right now, immediately sell off these stocks, instantly. And they did that. And then they found, hey, the stocks fell and this and that happened after that. So bhakti also Guru may take care of, but what is the Guru meant for? is Mukti. So here it is Brahmaji. So what does he go and ask? Adhihi Bhagavan, O Lord, Adhihi, please teach me. What? Brahma Vidyam Varishtham. The best knowledge, which is the knowledge of Brahman. Supreme knowledge is Brahman, Brahma Vidya. Of all the knowledges, the best knowledge is Brahman, knowledge of Brahman. So Varishtham means that. Superlative degree it is. So best. Brahma Vidyam Varishtham, the highest. Sada Sadbihi Sevyamanam, which is always pursued by the good people. Just think about it. A lot of people who say, I am good and I do good. Be good, do good. That's all is real enough in life. Why bother about anything else? And what is Upanishad saying? This is pursued by good people only. Because they are only the adhikaris to realize properly. The goodness must lead me to jignyasa. My goodness should not make me complacent in my seeking. My goodness must invoke that jignyasa to know the self. So sada sadbhi sevyamanam nigudham. This is a hidden knowledge, secret knowledge. Not, oh Swamiji, is available everywhere. It is still secret only. Even though it is available everywhere in books and whatever, CDs and tapes and audio and downloads and everything. Channels and channels are there. Still, nigudham. It is secret. Then, yaya achirat. Now, why should I know this? Because if I know this, achirat, very soon, by knowing this, sarva papam vyapohya, all the sins one will overcome, get all sins will be destroyed. Then what will happen? Parat param purusham yati vidvan. The supreme consciousness is realized by the vidwan, by the wise people. So this first shloka gives us who is the adhikari, meaning who is fit for Brahma Vidya. So sadbhi and vidwan, these two words indicate who is the adhikari. What is the vishaya? Brahma Vidyam Varishtham. The highest knowledge of the self is the subject matter of this text. Adhikari, Vishaya. Then Sambandha. What is the connection of this text? First we'll do Prayojan and then the Sambandha. So what is the Prayojan? Why should I know this text? Why should I study? What will be the benefit of this text? Sarva Papam Vyapohya Achirat Parat Param Purusham Yati. Destroying all the agitations, one will quickly realize the self. And what is the sambandha? Between the prayojan and the text is the sambandha. 100% there is. Because one will realize the truth by studying this. So, the anubandha chatushtaya is, these four things are called anubandha chatushtaya. Adhikari, vishay, Prayojan and Sambandha. They are indicated here. For today, I will stop here. Then we will continue more tomorrow morning. Now, all of us are here, I think. Three of you who were to join today, they all are here. So, welcome to the camp. Once again, my sincere request to all of you is, please ensure that the rules of our ashram are followed strictly in terms of especially going out. Please do not go out without permission. Whatever may be the reason, if you need to go out, please ask me so that we are aware that you have gone out, because all of you know this is a risk right now we all have taken. We have come here. And what we learned now, grace and self-effort, both are required. Grace of Bhagavan, we are here, but our effort has to be within the rules, so that it's a matter of so many people. So please follow that.